Today on our show,
a tiny little show with bits of news everywhere on today's Fat Man on Batman. Welcome back to Fat Man on Batman. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm not Kevin Smith.
Yes, he's the other guy.
I'm the other guy.
The non-Kevin Smith guy on the show. That is Mary Mark Bernardin, ladies and gentlemen. And we're here to tell you about all the news that's fit to print.
A week ago.
We're catching up on old stories. So this episode, we're going to tell you some stuff that you probably already know, but we're going to know it now. And once we know it, it is known. That's how we said it.
Nice. The speaker from the mountain is spoken.
Speaking of which, man, have you been watching Westworld?
I'm a couple of episodes behind on the Westworld, but I'm loving it.
So fun. So fun. And if you're a few episodes behind, the episodes you'll catch up on are a blast. Like, it's a good time, man. They're doing the Lord's work with that show. But now I'm worried. They said it's coming back, but it might not be back until 2018.
Well, that's HBO's way, you know, like they come back when they're ready. Remember when The Sopranos would take like 2.5 years off between seasons?
That was rough.
And they'd only come back for 6 episodes?
I had to go live a real life for a while.
The fuck is blue, that?
You know, I'm like, I want more Tony, Carmella.
You know, maybe watch First and 10 reruns. I need more Sopranos.
Wow, deep cuts. It's good. They're doing a really great job.
The season finale is probably not airing. Depending on when this drops, it will either just be about to air or
probably just about
having just aired. So maybe we'll do a deep dive. We talk about.
We should. Because Maeve, that's my spirit animal.
Ooh, Tandy. Tandy Newton.
I'm not even supposed to say spirit animal. It's Native American community.
Your Patronus.
That is my Patronus.
There you go.
Maeve is my Patronus. Oh, she's fantastic. And that was the storyline I honestly thought would be the least Tandy Newton storyline, least interesting to me when it started. I was like, the brothel, madam. Who knew that she was like the Moses of the show, the Jesus of the show.
Yes.
The Harry Potter of the show. Yeah, so it's been great. We'll deep dive into Westworld later on. But for now, Deadpool 2 has a director.
Not you.
Not Tim Miller either, sadly.
No. The internet didn't listen to us.
Nobody listened to us. The guy who's directing it is no slouch himself. Made a movie we all know and love called Name of John Wick.
Indeed.
That's right. His name is David Leitch.
Leitch, I believe.
David Leitch.
Longtime stunt coordinator.
Oh, is that where he came from?
Yeah.
John Wick is a good flick.
Oh, so much fun.
I put that on a poster. John Wick's a good flick, Kevin Smith.
No more rhyming. I mean it. Anybody want a peanut?
If you don't like this movie, you eat penis. Unless you like penis, in which case you eat the other thing.
Yeah. Best blurb ever.
Gotta make it equal. Yeah, that goes on the poster.
Where's the title? We got this Smith blurb.
The blurb's way too big. Hopefully they'll recognize the image.
Yeah, Dr. Zhivago.
This guy's going to direct Deadpool.
Yes, totally happy about that.
So you got somebody able-bodied behind the camera, knows how to shoot stunts, and apparently there'll be lots of that.
And he's got a sense for pulp.
And Ryan and the boys that wrote the first one will be back and large in charge making jokes.
Absolutely.
So Deadpool is all good.
It's all right.
Gotta close that heart. It was like an open heart like this. Dead M. Yeah. Speaking of Dead M, the guy that invented the Big Mac died today.
Aww.
Who knew that someone invented the Big Mac? But there was a gentleman in Pittsburgh.
Two old beef patties.
Special sauce.
Should we add a sauce?
Special sauce.
Special sauce.
Lettuce, cheese. Pickles.
Onions.
On a sesame seed bun.
Yes. Some dude put that shit together.
One of the greatest advertising jingles of all time that I'm 46 and I can still give you the recipe of the Big Mac based on the commercial. Two all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions, on a sesame seed bun.
Boom. And then gained too much weight because you're singing this song on the way to this shop.
Considered an icon of junk food, the Big Mac. Like, this is, you know, when people are like, this is America. And then there are people like, there's everything wrong with America. But does the Big Mac have just two pieces of bread or is there a third piece of bread?
There's a third piece of bread.
So that's the kind of, oh, look at the bigness of this.
Right. The opulence of America. Three pieces of bread.
What's that guy's name? Somebody look it up real quick. We should give him his propers. But it wasn't like Mac McGinnis.
Right.
Big Mac
probably
himself.
Not Irish.
No. It was a dude who had a couple franchises in Pittsburgh. And he was like, you know, I'd like to do something new. And they said, well, you know, McDonald's corporate, because they're all franchise, mm-hmm. was like, we're very happy with burgers, cheeseburgers, fries, and mm-hmm. shakes on the menu. Don't shake it up. And this guy was like, ah, I think I could do one better.
Yeah. And here's what you can do. You can charge twice as much.
And that's what they did.
Yes.
He made a burger that had two burgers. And his thing was like, the special sauce is going to be all the mm-hmm. rage. A lot of people assume it's just Thousand Island dressing, but it's Thousand Island dressing with something mm-hmm. else. His name is Michael Jim Delegate. Jim was his nickname?
Not Mike.
Why didn't they call the sandwich the Big Jim?
I don't know. Or why didn't they call it Mike? Because his name was Michael.
Big Mike.
Big Mike.
Close enough. Big Mike.
Yeah, fuck it.
Old Big Mike himself, or Little Mike, or whatever, he invented the Big Mac, a sandwich which I've enjoyed.
And kicked off what we have to now call the burger arms race.
Yeah, no doubt. Like, Burgernomics, if you will.
I mean,
but they didn't kick it off.
No?
I just read this today. Whopper went first.
Did it?
Whopper by 10 years.
Holy shit.
Burger King had the larger burger.
Ooh.
And, you know, McDonald's had such market dominance. They're like, go ahead, sell your Whopper. We don't care.
I don't give a shit.
The Big Mac was the shot across the Whopper's bow. That's what I read online. I would have thought vice versa. Big Mac went first and Whopper came later.
Well, maybe it was. That's the thing. Like, if you're Burger King, you've got to respond. Like, you're in a losing position. You're second place. You've got to do something outrageous and bold and fattening in order to gain some more traction.
Or like, are you tired of little McDonald's burgers or the minimum option?
Fuck that.
Fuck them right in their asshole. Come across the street to the King,
put
baby.
A Whopper in your face.
Right in your fucking mouth. The King's got a Whopper for you. Royale with cheese.
McDonald's like, well, let's sell you one better. The Duke of Malmesbury's rules.
Look
let's
at
get
this,
after this
quarter pounder with dick cheese. I was shocked. I would have thought Whopper was the, you know, our answer to the Big Mac. But apparently the Big Mac is the answer to the Whopper.
See, now there's a movie coming out at the end of the year called The Founder.
Which the one is movie I can't wait to see.
With Michael Keaton as Ray Kroc. Not quite the founder of McDonald's, but the dude who put the arches on it.
If you believe the plaques that were in all the stores. Right. I'd always stop and look. Our founder tells the story of Ray Kroc, but this tells the story of the McDonald's brothers.
Right.
And how Ray Kroc separated them from their hamburger.
Mm-hmm. And took it over and put the golden arches, and over 1 million served was his idea. He was a salesman.
Yeah. He was a shake machine salesman.
Mm.
And he had sold a couple shake machines to the McDonald's brothers, and they kind of hip him to like, well, we found a way to make burgers this fast. And he's like, this could go everywhere.
Mm.
And he became a bazillionaire.
But see, now I want to see the Burger Wars movie. I want to see the arms race between Whoppers and Big Macs and Double Whoppers and Quarter Pounders and McDLTs.
Burger Chef was involved, but they're casualty now. They're gone. Chattel. Roy Rogers maybe is in that.
Yeah, Wendy's.
They're gone too. Wendy's still hanging in there, man.
Wendy's
They're
is doing
like,
their
we're
best.
Fucking square. Our burgers are square, bitches. We stand out.
We got our redhead.
That was their gimmick. That's it, man. They're like, we give you square burgers. That's how you remember us. Yeah.
And then McDonald's was like, fuck it. We're going to give you a clown who's maybe not scary. And a grimace who's, what's a fucking grimace? I don't know.
You know Hamburglar what a grimace is?
Because crime.
You know what a grimace is?
Tell me what a grimace is.
Grimace is an upside down milkshake. You remove the cup, you take the shake, turn it upside down, that's the grimace.
So he's always in a state of suspended animation, not dying.
Who knew he was a shake? And that's why when you drink a shake, you grimace.
Oh.
That's what I was told. I had no idea.
You're sucking off a shake. You're sucking off that monster.
And grimace is
down.
Like, yes.
Do it.
Yes.
I don't want to melt.
I don't know if you're the Hamburglar, but you the fucking Cumburglar today. Oh, yes.
Steal my soul.
And now we'll never get a call. For McDonald's as a sponsor. Unless they're like, we're going another way and we like your hypersexualized version of our character.
The clown isn't selling anymore, so yeah. How about just fucking porn?
We got to get away from the clowns. Clowns are scary. All right.
Can I tell you my new favorite thing?
Do it.
It is a podcast that I listen to called My Dad Wrote a Porno. Have you ever heard of this podcast?
Great title.
Yeah, because this dude, this guy from Britain named Jamie, found out that his father wrote an erotic novel. And so he and his two best friends, also British, gay dude and a lady, read a chapter of this novel every episode.
That's hysterical.
And it's the worst fucking novel you've ever heard. It is so bad. And this dude has to read the thoughts coming out of his dad's head about awful porn shit.
That's kind of genius.
It's kind of magic. So I've decided when I listen to it, I imagine that it's like Harry and Ron and Hermione finding like James Potter's secret porn novel.
Nice.
Because it's adorable and British and awfully filthy.
I like how it's good enough, but you're like, I'll make it better.
by making
putting
it
through a Potter filter. Because makes everything better.
Your father's a fucking pervert.
What's your Patronus? Porntronus.
A giant fucking black dildo.
Comes out and just lands.
Pretty much. That's so that is dick. Related to nothing except to my favorite thing right now.
There it is. Get a plug right there. From
yeah,
Mark and Arnold.
Porno people.
Somebody hipping you something smooth. Mm. Speaking of smooth, Black Panther movie is happening.
Yeah.
We all loved his introduction in Civil War. I don't know anybody who didn't love his introduction.
Seriously.
It's pretty damn badass. That movie's taking shape. They've just added a major player to the Black Panther movie. Tell them who it is.
Tina Turner.
That's right. Tina Turner is going to be in her first movie since Thunderdome.
You don't need another hero.
It is the woman who played Tina Turner.
Yes, Angela Bassett.
Angela Bassett herself, which I remember at one time, weren't they always talking about, like, she should be Storm.
And then they back went in the day.
Way back in the day. But now she's going to be in Black Panther. I wonder who she's going to play.
Apparently, T'Challa's mother.
Really?
Yeah.
So her husband died in Civil War?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She's awesome. And what has she been in lately?
She's an American Horror Story.
And she's been directing as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
T'Challa's awesome. Chamama.
Big news, Chamama.
Chamama.
Big news. When is that movie due?
That movie is 2018, I think.
Wow, we gotta wait.
We do.
Movie we're not waiting very much longer for. Alien Covenant.
Yes.
Directed by Ridley Scott.
Xenomorph.
Sir Ridley Scott to you and me. Order of British Royalty.
Royal with cheese.
Ridley Scott, who is his birthday today?
His birthday was yesterday, I believe.
How old?
79 years old.
The fuck, really?
Spring chicken he is.
All right, he's 9 years older than my mother, and he's making Alien Covenant. Why isn't my mother making at least Alien, you know, fucking 3?
I don't know.
No, 4. 3 was good. Resurrection. My mom should have made Alien Resurrection by
she
this
could
point.
Be making the bad Alien movies.
It'd be amazing, man. People were like, why does your mother make those movies about aliens so bad? I'm like, you know, she's trying. She's fucking 70. And I'm shocked she understands most of these concepts. So bear with her. She'll get better.
I would rather watch your mom's Alien than Prometheus any day of the week.
Good point. Prometheus was the movie where you thought you were going to see some xenomorphs.
Yeah.
And you didn't really see that many. But remember they showed us like the Navigator and you're like, oh shit.
It's a fucking space jockey.
But
apparently the space jockey is in this one also.
Really?
Yeah.
He shows up, puts on the helmet and shit, and then dies in the chair.
As we all did watching Prometheus.
Ooh, slow death. But that right there, that is all the hope you need, man. That is strength, boy. That is power.
The strength and power of flesh.
Look We're at that girl. Using another movie to describe a different franchise. Come to me, my child. Come to me.
Look at the strength in your body.
It's coming, folks. Alien Covenant. And so what is this? The year one story of the aliens?
You know, that's what we thought Prometheus was, but unclear precisely.
The real year one story?
I mean, when
gonna have more than one, a bunch of them?
One can only fucking hope.
Alien had one. Ridley Scott did that, and it had one alien.
Right.
Jim Cameron made it brilliant when he was like,
this time we go to war.
We're going to pluralize this shit. Yeah. There's more than one. There's two or more, and there were a bunch. There's a ceiling, man.
They got the power.
What happened in three to go to Prison Planet, and that was one alien inside of her that became a dog.
And then another dog.
But still,
maybe.
We're back to like one alien. Then Alien Resurrection was that fucking terrible alien hybrid at the end that would just look like a mask turned inside.
Do you remember that teaser for Alien 3 that, I can't remember the movie that it was on, but it was only a teaser, but it was like snowscape and all of this shit, and it was just like ominous voiceover, and the end of it was, this time they come home. And then it crests over and you see like Anchorage or something. It was all stock footage. Like, it was nothing that they actually shot for the movie. But there was a teaser that threatened that the aliens were coming to Earth.
Why don't they do that story?
I don't fucking know.
Yeah, that's next. Man.
Although
maybe that's what this is.
Could be. I don't remember anything about Alien v. Predator, so I want to say that maybe it's possible
maybe
that
to Earth
did that, but that was bad. Other than
not
somehow
bad, it's just like maybe you're not in the mood for a Predator movie. Maybe you just want to see an alien come to Earth and fucking a xenomorph running crazy and ape shit. Without a predator, that just makes it hokey and unreal. But the alien by himself, that's metal.
Yeah, we only need one kind of alien at one time.
I that's cool.
Not two kinds of aliens.
I can't wait, man. Ridley Scott controlling an alien again. The man gave you the alien the first time.
Mm-hmm.
Him and Geiger. So he's back.
And maybe, like, is this a haunted house movie the way Alien was? Is it a war movie the way Aliens was? Let's just hope it's not a ponderous seminar on artificial intelligence and space travel the way Prometheus was.
What about the Fincher movie? That's a prison movie.
It's a prison movie. And then 4 was a basketball movie?
I remember swimming at one point.
It's like Sigourney Weaver's doing jump shots in this movie, I guess.
Strange movie. Okay, so Alien Covenant is coming like Christmas. When does it happen? Next year? Early next year?
Yeah, like March.
Ooh.
Early.
Summer comes early.
Summer comes early.
Let's end with that because that's...
Yeah, yeah, you know. I'll bring us down. But Lin-Manuel Miranda, the Pulitzer Prize winner, Tony winner, who wrote these songs and collaborated on the score for Hamilton and for Moana, currently in theaters.
That's right. He's done more than one thing. He's done a lot of things.
He's done a lot of things. Is moving, venturing into television.
He is not giving away his shot.
He is not giving away his shot. Yeah.
Yeah, he's working everywhere.
Really, and so he's moving into TV. He is going to be an executive producer and sort of music supervisor of this show called The King Killer Chronicle, which is about, look, this redheaded bard dude who's telling the stories in some medieval fantasy milieu, kind of Lord of the Rings, but with a lot more songs.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm in.
And so Lionsgate has an eye towards this as one of those... Remember what they promised us Dark Tower was going to be?
Yeah.
Just like we're going to do a movie and then a season of television, then another movie and then a season of television. Lionsgate has that kind of plan for this. They want to do movies and TV at the same time. And Lin will have a hand in almost all of it.
That's pretty dope, man.
Yeah.
Talent outs, man. He's insane.
Seriously.
Talented.
And he is having a run like few people have ever had a run.
Give him all the monies. He knows what he's doing.
They seem to be doing that.
Yeah. Yeah, you don't need armor, that's happening like
and
crazy.
He just did a drunk history where he got blasted and talked about the history of Hamilton, which is adorable.
Have you watched it?
Yeah,
it's good.
It's great. There's a moment where he's talking about whatever, like, and so him and Aaron Burr are about to have a duel, and then his cell phone rings, and of course the characters on screen are like, oh, Questlove, why is Questlove calling me? Questlove, I love you. And like Questlove is in the car with Christopher Jackson, who played George Washington in Hamilton. He's like, I love you guys. Listen, as long as I got a job, you got a job. As long as I got a job, you got a job. I love you. You're my best friend. Okay, bye. Drunk Lin-Manuel Miranda is hysterical.
That's genius.
And adorable.
All right, check that out.
Yeah, do that. Watch that.
And now we end with the show with sad news, ladies and gentlemen. We have to acknowledge two massive pop culture deaths. Let's go her first. Just
yes.
Because everybody knows Florence Henderson, even though, you know, it's not quite the geek space. Brady Bunch, you know, that belongs to everybody who's ever had a television from 1970 forward. America's mom, one might say, as you got to see her be the mom that you always wished your mom was. Level-headed, generous, supportive and crap like that. Never, those kids never got in trouble.
Almost
never. Saw them get punished, never saw them get slapped around or anything like that.
No.
And those shows were made during the spanking age where you can hit a child.
You totally could have taken Peter over a knee and given him what for.
If they were like, let's put that in the Brady Bunch. And Mike is just like, you dumb slut. He smacks Bobby.
Marsha, shut your fucking pie hole.
You're doing it wrong. You
Jen.
Know, this is why you're single with three fucking daughters in the first place. She's like, you're no fucking prize. You are single with three boys of your own.
This is the weirdest eulogy.
Florence Henderson was not engaged in that version of the Brady Bunch. Florence Henderson passed away, sadly.
She
age 82?
I believe so.
Man, I thought she'd live forever. I thought she'd live longer than me, that's for sure. But all things come to an end.
Yeah, TV's mom has baked her final cake.
But she'll forever be...
Syndication is there for everybody.
And maybe her final gift to that show, because her gift to that show all throughout its production was she was the calm center of the show. You loved her, man. She was amazing.
Yeah.
her gift to that show would probably be a bunch of people who are like, oh, The Brady Bunch, I haven't watched that in a while.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure it's one of those shows that it hasn't been off, you know, ever since it's been on the air, it's been on in like this many countries and stuff. Or maybe it's a very uniquely American thing, I'm not quite sure. But it, for our generation, it was everything. My kid, she don't know from The Brady Bunch.
No, neither do mine. And to a certain degree, neither should they. But they were there for us, and she was my mom. Except for the mom that I have.
Our real moms, who did a much better job than our fake TV mom. But she was
really, yes, so, absolutely.
Florence Henderson, thank you.
We bid you adieu.
We bid you adieu. Thank you, Mom. Thank you, Mrs. Brady. I guess it's not really proper for me to call her my mom.
Yeah,
thank you,
not.
Mrs. Brady.
And we also lost Ron Glass.
Yeah, this is now, you're talking about TV royalty from like a couple decades, right?
Yes.
You're talking about Barney Miller.
In the 70s.
And then you're 80s. Talking about Firefly.
Indeed.
And now you know Firefly world, I don't. Who did he play in Firefly?
He played a character named Shepherd Book, who was a man of God, who had a past that the show never actually explored very much. They kept hinting at the reason why this man who seemed to be pretty good with a gun, who was not bad with his hands, ended up in a monastery. They alluded to the fact that he'd had some history, potentially as an assassin, potentially as a gun for hire, who forego those ways and decided to follow the path.
Hmm.
And he was the sort of spiritual center of that show, and often in contrast with our boy Nathan Fillion, who was the sort of agnostic, pragmatic captain of the ship.
Hmm.
And so there was always a tension between them that eventually sort of got resolved when the shepherd just said, listen, I don't care what you believe. It's just important that you believe in something. And he was that rock of that show. He was, you know, while not the captain, he was the one that kept the moral spheres in line.
Mm.
And he brought that kind of grace and that kind of dignity to that stage that you needed when everybody else is sort of young and impetuous and possibly attractive. And then you get Ron Glass, who was just this man of ebony rock who could hold it down.
Ebony Rock, I believe, is the name of his biography that you're now penning.
Yes, also his K-Tel special.
Ebony Rock.
Ebony Rock, Superstars of the 70s.
I don't know the Firefly theme song, but I do remember Barney Miller. So maybe we should send Ron Glass off with a little boom, 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 boom. Boom, 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 boom,
long song.
Has this been another episode of Fat Man on Batman? My name is Mark Bernard. That is Toots McGee.
That's for Ron Glass, man.
Indeed.
Farewell, storyteller, fellow entertainer, and better entertainer than the two of us combined.
That was pretty good, though.
That's not bad, right?
Yeah.
One-man show. See my one-man show, Barney Miller. That took a lot out of me. I almost passed out. Ironically, the thing that robbed me of breath, smoking weed, was the thing that gave me enough courage to do the whole song as a eulogy.
Oh, it gives and it takes.
There it is, folks. For Fat Man on Batman, I've been Kevin Smith.
I've been Mark Bernard.
Tune in for the next episode, man. The same fat time, same fat channels, podcast.com or
YouTube.com/KevinSmith.